This is a great honor. Thank you first for your service, and thank you to all those here and those watching in live stream land who served our country. Great person to talk to about leadership. You've been a soldier, been a leader in the military, lead your own business. You're an author. You're the star in a TED Talk. If you go on to TED, there's a TED Talk where I never thought that a person could get so many chuckles from talking about how you get suited up to get into a parachute. When was that moment where you said, I'm the guy, I can be a leader? Because most people can't. Most people don't have the capacity. Most people don't have the ambition or the self-certainty to do it. When did you think I can?
I think early in any career, you first focus on trying to be competent at what you do, whether it's banking or reporting or whatever you do. And you spend a lot of time on that. But parallel to that, you're in positions where you lead, particularly in the military. And I think when I was a lieutenant, in my first assignment at the 82nd Airborne Division, and you're making every mistake known to man, you have times when you think that you just don't have the knack to connect with people, and you try just about it. If you're like me, you try every style. You try being a real nice guy, then you try being a heavy-handed autocrat. You bounce back and forth, and so I think for me it was probably about 5 or 6 years into that when suddenly I started to find out who I am. I didn't try to be anybody else. I didn't try to be...
You're how old at that point?
I'm sorry?
You're how old at that point?
I'd be about 28. You're a captain. Right. And you suddenly can do things that seem right for you. You're not reading books and trying to be George Patton or trying to be Ulysses S. Grant or trying to be anybody else. You just have sort of figured out what your abilities and limitations allow you to do. And so I think it was about that point when I thought I could do it, and I also found out that I liked doing it and I wanted to do it.
What did you think you were really good at back then that you've realized now in retrospect you weren't?
Yeah, it's funny. In the first parts of my career, I thought I was very good at running things, and so I became very much a micromanager. When I had a mechanized infantry battalion, you have 14 armored vehicles. I put them all on the same radio frequency, so I could talk to all the vehicles at once, and I said, turn left, all 14 vehicles turn left automatically, and I thought, my God, I'm an amazing leader here. and to some extent, that's probably the most obedience I've ever gotten since. But I found out that, I thought at that point that if you really got control of things, and if you understood everything what was happening, and you made the decisions like that, you could control things to a level that you could get the standards that you wanted. I learned not long after that that's true to a certain sized organization, maybe about 100 and 120 guys, like an infantry company. Then once you get past that, it doesn't work anymore. And you try to do it through people, and suddenly you realize that model was wrong to begin with. And so what I learned to do, and I had some help from subordinates of mine who just weren't going to put up with micromanagement, and they, particularly when I commanded a Ranger company, and they explained, hey, listen, we know how to do this business. Your role is not to do our jobs. Your role is to help us do our jobs, to give us an environment to do that. And I think that started a change in the way I think about leadership that continued through the rest of my career.
You said that, quote, I came to believe that a leader isn't good because they're right, they're good because they're willing to learn and to trust. Basically gets at the self-awareness that I don't think people appreciate enough out of good leaders. Be self-aware, critique yourself. Like, your greatest weakness as a leader is what?
Yeah, I got a bunch of them, and I'm not being falsely modest here. I'm lazy, for one. And
I can tell by your
career. No, I mean, I'm actually lazy in ways that don't show. I won't do my homework all the time. I won't do all the reading to prep. I won't study something. I don't think when I went through most military schools, I never read the FMs, and I escaped from my career not having read a lot of those things. I will make decisions too quickly sometimes. If people will come to me with information, I will get a certain amount of information, and I want to be decisive, so boom, I'll make a decision. And sometimes that's not yet informed enough. I get moody. I don't think I'm as bad as I used to be, but I will get frustrated, and that will make it hard for people to interact with me. And it's not stuck on one time of the day. It's not morning or night, but I will do that. And when I get tired, I'm not as good a leader as when I'm not tired. Particularly if I'm, you know, exhausted physically, I lose my patience. And of course, that makes it harder for people to deal with you. And so,
what's a specific adjustment you've made to offset one of those weaknesses?
Yeah.
Sleep more?
I do try to sleep more now, but one thing is to sort of step back and don't make yourself responsible for doing too much. As you get more senior, one of the first things you learn is your job is to create an ecosystem into which people can operate. So do that. Don't fall in the temptation of doing what you did when you were younger because you're still good at it, or you think you're still good at it, because that's not your job anymore. When we were going over to Afghanistan, I remember my Dave Rodriguez, a classmate of mine, was selected to be my deputy and to go over initially, and then he took Combined Forces Afghanistan at the three-star job. And he told me, he goes, Stan, we're going to go over there and you are going to deal with President Karzai and I'm going to fight the war. And I'm, you know, my office at the Pentagon, I said, no, Rod, that's not the way it's going to work because I am a great war fighter and I really like war fighting. And so I'm going to do that and you're going to do the politics, which probably would have been better. But but he goes, no, right. You don't get it. Only the commander can do those things that only the commander can do. Only the commander can form a relationship with President Karzai. Only the commander can, you know, do those things. So we have to do this. And he was, of course, completely right. So it took a little bit of self-control to then sort of divorce myself from moving forces around on the map because that wasn't what I should best spend my time at.
And you wouldn't have gotten where you're at and wouldn't have the confidence that you do if you have not made like some brilliant decisions along the way. Take us behind the scenes on one, like one where you feel like, had I not done that, other people in that situation would not have done what I did. I made a smart decision and it saved lives or it changed the trajectory of a battle or it changed an institution. Is there like a very specific one that you can walk us through?
Yeah, I mean, I picked my wife, you know, asked her to marry me. That was literally brilliant. I think the thing I am most proud of was not a single decision. It was in Joint Special Operations Command. And what we did was we had an organization that was functionally excellent. I mean, we were better than any organization has ever been at the kinds of things that that very elite organization was designed to do. And it was designed for very specific high-end counterterrorist and special operations missions. And because we were so good, that was our identity. Our identity was in this excellence and whatnot. The problem was we weren't right for the problem at hand. In Iraq, starting in late 2003 when I took over, what I'd found was we could do what we were doing at this incredible level of effectiveness, but the war kept getting worse and we weren't making a big enough contribution to changing that fact. So it was one of these moments where you come and you say, we can continue to do what we do and do it really well, and people will pat us on the back and say, you're great. And things can get worse, or we can step back and say, we have got to make a bigger contribution to the overall effort at the risk of stepping away from that which is comfortable to us and whatnot. And we made that decision, and that was one of the ones that I became most committed to, and it really carried on through the whole time in command, because we were changing what we did, who we were, how we interacted with other organizations, and we were doing it in a way that was at least upsetting internal to the organization. It was well received by some of our partners and it was not well received by others, you know, other federal agencies and other military groups and whatnot. But it was fundamentally essential for us to perform the part of our role in the fight in Iraq and of course Afghanistan. And so there wasn't a brilliance to a single decision I made, but what I will say is I learned that once you make a decision like that, it's consistent commitment to it. It's never giving up the energy on that. You know, you turn something and then you got to start pushing it and overcome inertial momentum. And if anything that I felt we did best, it's just staying at that day after day after day, because there's resistance. There's people who go, well, you know, this isn't going to work. And sometimes I think genius lies more in persistence than it does in some kind of sudden.
Were there any specific tricks, though? Because at that time, the government had done all these exhaustive studies to figure out, like, how do we fight a war now? How does our enemy actually fight a war? From that, you came up with this concept of actionable intelligence and the virtuous cycle of intelligence. It's hard enough for me to get, like, 10 people to do what you want them to do. Like, how the hell do you get the entire military to suddenly go from a mindset that was created in Vietnam to completely changing itself, at least in the theater that you were involved in once you get into Afghanistan?
Well, I think the thing that was noteworthy about us is when I took command in the fall of 2003, as I mentioned, it's already a great organization, and yet we need to change because the requirements changed. But not only is the requirement changed, the requirement is changing. And so instead of us having to figure out the problem and then work a perfect solution to it, what we had to do was aim at a moving target, because Al-Qaeda and associated movements was this resilient network of associations that was constantly morphing. It was a dynamic moving target. So as a consequence, I didn't have a clue how to beat them when we started. All I knew that what we were doing wasn't right. And so what we did was first overcame the inertial momentum, just get everybody to the idea that, and one of my young officers coined the thing, he says, sir, you can't steer anything until it's moving. So let's get it moving, and then we will fix it. Now, a lot of people, well, not a lot, but some said, you know, we shouldn't rush to failure. We need to do a study. We need to get a perfect plan on where we're going. But the reality is we didn't know where we were going because we didn't know where the enemy was going, and we hadn't yet figured out what worked. So instead, the mindset and the command became, what we're going to do is start moving, and then we are going to develop this organization that senses, learns, and communicates across the organization those lessons and adjustments in real time, faster than I had ever seen before. And that's what it became. The organization became this organism that just took in information, took in hard lessons, sometimes it bought at great cost, and adjusted constantly. But instead of having a top-down structure where those lessons had to be painfully pushed to the top and then studied and then pushed down, we created this. It's not just flat. It was this organism-like thing where information flowed everywhere, and so decisions were made much closer to the problem because everybody was learning at the same time. We call it shared consciousness now. And it's contextual understanding that gives you this confidence that you know the big picture, and therefore you don't have to ask permission exactly how to do this task, because you know the big picture. You know what needs to be done, and nobody can give you the right guidance from the top because things are changing too fast for that to work.
What's the worst decision you've made?
Well, I've made a bunch of them. I think the places where I most think I failed was in certain relationships. And every time I spent a lot of time making sure the relationship with an organization or individuals was right, it paid off in spades. And other cases where it wasn't as functional as it needed to be, and for any number of reasons, I didn't fix it, and I didn't put enough effort in it, the command paid a price, not just me, the command did. And if somebody in another organization irritates you, or you just don't like them, every once in a while you say, well, guess what? I'm just not going to deal with that person. I'll find an excuse not to. The price for that is just incalculable. And so when you're in a leadership position, you don't have you can have whatever personal feelings you want. You don't have the luxury of allowing them to be operationalized by what you do and don't do and be petulant or whatever. And I was very lucky the people surrounded me, because a number of times I would literally go against the wall of our situational awareness room and I would pound on the plywood and I'd say, that's it, we're cutting off diplomatic relationships with that organization, you know, other part of the government. When they'd talk me back from the ledge and they go, no, sir, you always say that relationships are more important. And they were always right. And they were repeating my own mantra back to me. But you need, I think that's the thing that can so often submarine otherwise great plans.
In the book, you spend about a page and a half on the Rolling Stone article. You've written a couple blog posts recently talking about that. People are familiar enough with the narrative at all, but what were you thinking at the time going into it? It's Rolling Stone. You're in the military, and you're thinking, I'm going to give these guys access. Why?
Yeah. Well, first off, for context.
You were pretty clear, but you knew a lot about PR. You've done a lot. I mean, you're very savvy on the public relations side of things and the importance of what was being projected.
Yeah, I wouldn't give myself credit for that because I'd spent the years in JSOC where there was no public, so I wouldn't give myself credit. I did understand it was important, but contextually, we did a whole bunch of press. You know, the war in Afghanistan in the fall of 2009 and spring of 2010 wasn't very popular in the US, and it wasn't very popular in Europe. And so we felt this incredible need to communicate the story to build up support. I did the first 60 Minutes interview the summer of 2009. Mm-hmm. Literally, I did it kicking and screaming. Some of my team said, you got to do this. And I said, oh my God, the last thing I ever want to do is be on 60 Minutes, you know, extreme close-up sort of thing. But they said, if you don't do this, we're not going to be able to get the public audience and the ear of people to start to make the case on how we need to change this strategy. So we did it. And then we did a whole bunch of media, and a number of embeds. And I remember they came to me on this one. They said, we want to do with Rolling Stone. And I, like you, I said, Rolling Stone? I mean, I don't even read it. Why would I do that? And they said, well, it's a different audience, and this piece is going to be focused on this. And so it was one of a number of embeds. It wasn't a unique thing until the story came out, of course.
Nobody knows Afghanistan arguably better than you do. You were there forever. You spent a lot of time thinking about what works, what doesn't work there. You changed the approach in Afghanistan. What will Afghanistan look like 5 years from now? Yeah.
Of course, it's impossible to say with confidence. I tell you what I think it could look like. I think that the Afghans, they're survivors. They've proven that many times over. The question is, are they political accommodators to the point? Now, that's the big question. They've got an army. They've got a police force, which is not where it wants to be. But they've got an army they're proud of. They have the capacity to be an effective society that is durable, even against things like Taliban pressure. The weakness or the challenge will come in their internal politics, because the people of Afghanistan lack confidence. They lack confidence in external relationships to countries like the U.S. They lack confidence that neighbors like Pakistan will give them the breathing room to do it. And then they lack confidence in their local politicians, and they lack confidence in their national politicians. And so when you lack confidence in something, you withhold your participation, your support. Think of the most confident person in the world, at least who shows the most faith, is the farmer, because they plant something confident that it's going to be something that they can harvest later. In Afghanistan, you start to see a lot of the behavior in many cases of people who are taking a very short-term view of things because they think that things are going to stay tumultuous, so you got to protect what I've got right now. If we lacked similar confidence, we wouldn't put our money in the banks. We wouldn't send our kids into the military or things like that. We just wouldn't invest in those things as society. Afghanistan's got to get over that, and the governance level is going to be the most public part of that. So if they can pull that together, and I actually think they've got a reasonable chance to do that, then I think it will motor along. I mean, it won't be perfect, but no country is, but I think that it will. If they can't do that, then it's going to be a different outcome.
What would it have looked like if we just did nothing?
Well, that depends when you pick your point in history. If we had done nothing in the 80s to support the Mujahideen, potentially the Soviets would have still been there. If we had done nothing in 2001, then Al-Qaeda would have remained there. Had we left after Al-Qaeda was ejected in late 2001 and left the Afghans to their own devices, what we would have had is a country that was damaged by the Soviet war, then traumatized by another decade of civil war and the rise of warlords, then suddenly the upending of the Taliban government. So in the fall of 2001, they'd had 20 years of this incredible sort of upset, and kids hadn't been in school and all these different things. So had we walked out then I think what we would have seen is a rise of the warlord-driven civil war that had been in the early 90s. And the Taliban were really accepted in 1994 through 96 because they swept that away. The people were so tired of it. I think that's what would have come back.
Well, the young gentleman over there looks like he's 13, 14 years old. When we think about it, it seems like we have this debate. Now it's about ISIS and whether or not we authorize the use of military force to go and kill people who want to kill us. Is there ever going to be a point for that young man or for any of us in this room where we're not at war? Doesn't ISIS just manifest itself in some other acronym that wants to use the same brutal means to terrorize us here or abroad? Isn't that just the reality forever?
Yeah. If you look at modern society now, there's something that I call the power of one. Single individuals can do things they couldn't do before. A single individual now with a automatic weapon in the U.S. can have quite an effect. A single individual with a weapon of mass destruction, chemical, biological, or nuclear, can have quite an effect. A single individual with a computer can potentially have a huge effect. So single individuals or small groups can do more than they ever could before. And there were small groups, there have always been small groups who didn't, agree with us, but they were over yonder. And they didn't matter so much on a daily basis. I mean, most of us remember the Barbary pirates. Things like that lasted for 20 years, but they only affected part of our economy until we decided to act on it. So I think the difference is you've got these organizations which before didn't have the reach or didn't have the technology or didn't have the media standing to do much, can do that more, which actually encourages them, because they see more about it and they go, well, if they did it, you know, I can do it. And so I think at least for the foreseeable future, probably 10 or 20 years, it's very likely that we'll see a series of challenges from groups from across the spectrum, not maybe just against the United States, but against other existing structures, government structures, business structures, religious structures. We'll have all of those under assault, and we're going to have this difficult decision over how we want to deal with it. Because in some countries, there's going to be a great temptation to lock down, and the government is going to get tight control, and we are going to get, because technology also helps both ways. You can know a lot more about people now. So I think there's a chance that we're going to go into this incredible police state in many areas, because people want order, and many people are willing to pay quite a price for order. So that will be one possible. The other possible is you get this chaos in areas that can't be controlled, like Somalia was and whatnot, where you just, you have this lack of centralized control and people are going to deal with them for themselves. Now, in the middle would be a perfect sweet spot of maybe democratically run governments with enough control that you could have society and property rights and whatnot, but enough freedom so that people don't have their civil liberties infringed. But that's a pretty delicate sweet spot to maintain. And history hasn't been in that sweet spot most of history. So we are going to have to work really hard to work toward that. But I think it's going to be a challenge. It's not an I don't think that that kind of society is an automatic end state to development. You progress, then you suddenly hit democracy and civil rights and all these things. I think instead it's this balance that you maintain and protect every day, because otherwise it tilts one way or it tilts the other.
It's clear, we'll go to questions after this one. It's clear in the next presidential election that one of the big debates is about leadership in the context of global leadership, on sort of how much certainty and how robust a military presence we have versus how much nuance we want to practice. I'm not going to ask you to critique the commander-in-chief, but could you look at the last two commander-in-chiefs and talk about what are their greatest strengths when you look at them as leaders as it pertains to our global position?
Yeah, I think the first and foremost is both of the presidents I got to work with care, and they got the right intentions. And you say, well, that's pretty obvious. No, that's not always obvious. Right. Both of them were trying to get the right outcome for the right reasons. Now, both of them were challenged with very different circumstances when they came into power, and then the events that changed George W. Bush's presidency, and then the things that Barack Obama has challenged. So I think that both of them had that challenge. I think that the two things that I think we need to think most about is credibility. You know, when you have a foreign policy, it is based upon credibility. And part of the credibility is your values and your willingness to reflect them. But part of credibility is your ability to do something and your willingness to do it. So if, for example, the United States says, we would like this to happen or not happen in the world, everyone in the world makes a calculation. They said, one, can the United States cause that to happen or stop it from happening? And are they willing to do it? And those are two different things, but they go together. If they question both or either, then they make a calculation that says, man, maybe we'll try this. Maybe we'll do it. So American credibility matters a lot. And it matters to our allies, and it matters to our potential foes. So I think you only build that up through demonstrated action. You can't talk your way to it. You can't get up and say, these are our values, got to believe us, unless we practice those values. And you can't say, we're going to be strong, unless you show you're strong and firm and all the sorts of things. So credibility is the key thing.
But it's not hard to build up. I mean, because now it's almost every single day it's a new challenge. And even if you take the critics of the president sort of and say, yes, you're right. We should have been into Syria earlier. And sure, you didn't handle Libya right now. We definitely have to go after ISIS. Anybody who looks at these are complicated things. And being able to show credibility or inconsistency,
right,
is that even possible?
Well, see, that is what makes it so darn hard. You're exactly right. And a president really uses the credibility his predecessors established. Now, that individual can add a little bit because of their personal words and actions, but the reality is you are operating on credibility built, and you are building it for your successor, not A lot of it's not going to come until after you're done, so that's one. But the second one I was going to say is relationships. You know, think about who we do things for. If you got a phone call right now and someone asked me, hey, can I borrow X amount of money or can you give me X amount of money? You know, there's people fall into two groups, those who you wouldn't return a call or wouldn't say yes, and those to whom you would. And relationships, that's a very simplistic view, but relationships matter a lot. And they're not just between countries, they're between people. One of the things that I was struck over time was, is so much of not just politics, but diplomacy is built on the sinew of personal relationships. And people place great value and great importance on those. And if we think that we can go in and just make a stated case and the searing logic of our position will sell the day, that's not my experience. My experience is that what people do is they do a much more complex calculus of, do they trust you? Do you have that relationship? And do they value the relationship enough to give a little bit on this one so that they can maintain that relationship for the future? So I think this give and take of relationships between individuals and organizations and nations is really, really important. And it doesn't come automatically. It's another thing you got to work at. It's like I tell people, if you think about marriage, that you meet, you fall in love, you get married, you live happily ever after, welcome to the real world. You meet, get married, work your rear end off every day at it, or you don't live happily ever after. Right. And that's the thing that we sometimes don't pay as much attention to as I would hope we would.
Good. Let's open it up to questions. I think there's a microphone, if we can. Why don't you start over here, we'll work your way up so we get the microphone towards you.
General, thank you for your service. My question is about shared sacrifice. I'm a big supporter of volunteer force. I have two sons on active duty, one who just came back from an unnamed Middle Eastern country. But I think we've been working so hard that the rest of America doesn't need to worry about it because we have an all-volunteer force. I think there's a huge disconnect between the military and the families and what they have to go through and what everybody else understands. And I think there's a huge disconnect between the policies that support those troops. And I'm wondering about your comments on that. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to take it on two things. First, thank your sons for their service, and thanks for your comment. First is within the military. It's a two-bladed sword here, because on the one hand, exactly as you described it, the military can get out of touch with the civilian side of society, and the civilian part of society just doesn't feel it. During the Civil War, one out of every 68 Americans was wounded. So everybody saw or knew somebody who was wounded. Now it's like one out of every 7,300 Americans. So most of us never meet anybody who's wounded, or if you do, it's just in passing. So it's not, that sacrifice isn't viscerally felt. That's part of it. The other side of that sword, though, is when you have a military that becomes more insular, and I used to go to bases all the time around, and every time I got to a base of platoon or size, I almost was sure that the platoon leader, platoon sergeant, a squad leader, or somebody was the son or daughter of a friend of mine in service. Now, on the one hand, that's very comfortable because you go, and hey, how's your dad, how's your mom, that sort of stuff. On the other hand, we're seeing ourselves all the time, and a military can start to get self-righteous, not intentionally, but the military can start to say, well, you know, We're the only people out here fighting, and that's a dangerous germ to start growing. And it really hasn't proven much in the military, but that's a dangerous thing to have. So that's first. Second, I would expand this much more broadly. Most Americans aren't asked to do anything except vote and pay taxes. And the reality is, if we think that's citizenship, that is not my view of citizenship. You know, as you may or may not know, I'm the chairperson for an effort to put national service for all young Americans into reality. And that is not military service, but something, you know, teaching, conservation, something. Everybody does a service year for a modest living stipend, $12,000 to $15,000, not for the work you get done during that year, but for the difference it makes in the person that does it, because you become different. You have a different sense of contribution, a different feeling of pride. And in reality, you also get to know people you wouldn't know otherwise. And you suddenly go, wow, they're not so different, or they're not so bad. It changes our view of citizenship, and I think that's critical that we do it. And I've got one of my colleagues here, Anmar, with me. Great.
We'll work our way up here. Either one, we can move that one.
General, thank you for your service. Quick question, you alluded to it earlier on the power of one, the access to a computer. So we saw, obviously, with the Arab Spring and Benghazi with the YouTube video, and now ISIS, the role that social media plays in the PR battle. So my question to you is, what are current or future military leaders doing to prepare for that side of it? Is there training there, and what role will that play in the future?
Yeah. What you really saw play out in Tahrir Square and other places is the power of real complexity and speed now. So two things came together, the speed and interconnectedness, and suddenly they wound themselves at a speed we've never seen in history. So the reality is that nobody knew what was going to happen when the Arab Spring started. It wasn't like this discipline movement that started with a plan and we'll do this, et cetera, et cetera. What it was this series of things that fed off each other in a completely unpredictable fashion, impossible to predict. And so social media allows that to happen, and it produces this swirling level of complexity that our organizations and leaders aren't prepared for right now. Because look at what, you know, we saw the Egyptian government was just stunned by Tahrir Square, call for a strike or a demonstration. A week later, all those people showed up and the government didn't know what to do. Well, nor did the US government. We were also chasing the information and chasing the developments. So what I think the key is going to be, and what I hope the military is doing now, but every organization's got to do, is change the mindset. They got to say, all right, we are not preparing for anything in particular. We are preparing for this constant change, and we're preparing to be adaptable. And you say, well, how do you do that? And the reality is you create teams and you create ways of communicating, very similar to the experience that we sort of backed into in JSOC. So that you, every day you walk out onto the field and you're playing a different sport. And so you go, wow, today it's soccer, tomorrow it's baseball, next day. It's that stunning a difference, and that's what I think organizations are going to have to do. You're no longer going to be able to perfect your ability to do one thing and get it just right. You're going to go out there, and it's going to be very frustrating to people, and that's why the structures and the roles of leaders are going to be so dramatically different. Or they're going to catch themselves looking at headlights, and they're going to get run over.
One more from this table.
Sir, Captain Fernandez, a question for you about civil-military relations. So there's been lots of discussion about civil-military relations over the past couple of years. Some people think that it's an institutional issue. Some people think it's the personal relationships that you've talked about so much. I'm curious, where do you think it falls on both, and what can be done to improve, both from an institutional standpoint, which I think would be more long-lasting, or a personal, obviously, I think you've talked a little bit about the personal part already.
Yeah, well, I think they are related. If you go back in history and you look at Team of Rivals, what President Lincoln put together, and we remember how good it was when he and Ulysses S. Grant in the last couple of years of the war had this pretty good relationship. You know, it took some painful years to get to that. And you look at the beginning of any of our major efforts where we've got to work together. I think that ultimately it takes really good relationships. It takes people who trust each other, but you can't do this thing where you just keep going through people until you find out people who happen to be from the same hometown or like each other. You can't build a structure and an expectation based upon serendipity of like personalities or mutually agreeable personalities. You've got to create organizations and you've got to create processes that force that. Now, one of the things I would say is if you think back to a sports team you might have been on at the beginning of the season, your coach typically pulled all the people together and you started practicing, you did some team building things, a number of things you did just to get them together. We take the United States' most senior leadership, the National Security Council, who are going to execute a war, and we take people who really don't know each other. They might, a few of them might, but often they don't. They come together in a room wearing suits or dresses, and so you're sort of in your stilted special personality, because I'm not always exactly like this. And you want them to suddenly become this team. And yet they're from different backgrounds. Military guys grew up in the military, they speak military, they've got a different background. Civilians are from different, and they didn't, for the most part, spend time together. They weren't at each other's weddings. They didn't often read the same books. And it's just as true across parts of the military. If you take the Intel Service and the Department of State, they're speaking different languages. It's all English, but it's different. And so we expect this team to come together seamlessly, and I think that's unrealistic, particularly at the speed it has to happen. So I think we need to step back and say, if you want teams like that to work, you've got to create a process to build that team together. You know, I always joke with people. They say, what would you do? I said, if we're going to go to war again, I tell the president to take his top 15 or 20 people and go whitewater rafting. And go, I'm not kidding, take several cases of beer, go whitewater rafting, don't invite the media. Do all those things you do whitewater rafting and just get to know each other. Just pull each other out of the water. Just see each other, you know, when they're not in a suit and protecting something. Not because you're going to solve the policy problem, but because when you're doing these very difficult interactions, you can look and you go, you know, I disagree with you, but I know you. You're not a total jerk, and so let me at least calibrate my ears to listen. And people laugh and say, well, that's the kumbaya thing. I tell you what, I don't agree. I think it's, as long as we are going to do this with people, and I don't see a change in that in the near term, we need to do things like that.
I have a question. I want to get one question from this side of the room, and maybe if the young gentleman wants to think of one while I ask a question of the general. What is one thing that leaders on the civilian side can learn from the military? That, like, they get, the military just gets it so right, and I wish you could export that to the civilian side. What it'd be what?
They're remarkably similar once you get past acronyms. Right. I mean, what I see. I think the military talks about leadership a lot, and we say that's not important. That is important. The military, your efficiency ratings, the name of your job, typically, the way you are admired or not admired, always has leadership in the terminology. There's very rarely a bottom line that said, that person made X amount of money, or that person got this many bills passed. It said, that person motivated, took care of soldiers, and that sort of thing. And I think just the focus on talking about it and making it so overt in your culture actually helps it be true. And I think that that would be advantage for any organization.
Good. We'll wrap up on this side. Do you have a question, buddy?
Yeah.
All right.
So I have a question. How do you see drones getting more involved in modern warfare in the next 20 or so years, and how is that going to affect troops on the battlefield?
And what college are you in right now? No, that's a great question. First off, I think I'm a big fan of unmanned aerial vehicles, and I think that in maybe not my lifetime, but in your lifetime, you're going to fly on commercial airliners that are remotely piloted. It's going to happen. Once my generation who says, it can't ever happen, it will. So I think that unmanned aerial vehicles are going to be prolific in everything, to include ground vehicles. In war, they're funny because there's two things to them. On the one hand, for our special operating forces, unmanned aerial vehicles allowed us to change the way we fought. There were certain technologies, global positioning system, precision weapons, night vision, the internet allowed us to connect, and unmanned aerial vehicles. And everybody thinks it's because we could shoot somebody with a missile. No. What it did was, in the old days, if we wanted to raid something, raid your house, we'd use about 120 people, because we'd take about 80 of them, we'd create a cordon about, you know, a half a mile from your house to stop anybody else from reinforcing it or to stop the people inside from getting away. We'd take others for support and command and control, and then we'd have a very small force that actually raided the house. But nowadays, by using unmanned aerial vehicles, all of those other things can be done because you see. You had to put security as a hedge against what you didn't know. So we could do raids with 20 people. So now instead of doing one raid with 120, we were doing six at the same time with 20 each, which sped up the pace of what we could do. And so hugely effective. Just, you know, an efficiency and an effectiveness boom. The problem with unmanned aerial vehicles is they allow you to lower the threshold of some things, like you can fly over an area with no risk to Americans, and you can shoot missiles down or drop bombs. And it feels almost antiseptic for us. I tell people in 1998, and you won't remember this, but people in the room will, President Clinton shot Tomahawks after we had intelligence on Osama bin Laden and whatnot. And if you'd asked Americans the next morning, is America at war? People would go, no, we shot some tomahawks, we're not at war. If you had been talked to people near the receiving end of those tomahawks, very different response. And so the danger is you've got different thresholds. You're shooting at someone and they go, looks, feels like war to me. And when you're in another position, you say, well, we are just doing surgical operations. And so you can get this resentment at American arrogance. Americans can be perceived as, we're arrogant because we can stand up from the heavens and be like Thor throwing thunderbolts. And although militarily it may be just the right move, if you are building up massive resentment, then there's a negative cost to it. So I think it's one of those technologies that has to be very carefully balanced as we use it. Now, pretty soon everybody's going to have them. A lot of countries have them now. And I don't know how we'll feel when somebody does it to us, but I can predict. So that's a great question. Thank you.
Well, with that, I want to thank Bank of America for hosting us. Thank all of you for participating in the conversation. Thank you, General.
Excellent.
Appreciate it. Thank you.